There we go. Hello, everyone. I'm standing to you. There are a bunch of bays around here, but this is Westport Marina in Westport, Washington. We just had a nice lunch. We went and saw the Cranberry Harvest Festival in Grayland, and it was fun. So I'm just kind of testing, seeing how sounds work, how focus works, things like that, and probably getting used to the idea of doing what I'm doing right now, standing out in public talking in front of a camera. Yeah, what can I say? Imagine yourself doing this. Yeah, if you got something to say, you should imagine it. If you got something you think is important. What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to introduce you. I have a whole bunch of videos that no one has ever seen. Some of them I shot years ago. This is going to be one of them. This is with Stanton Friedman. He was a physicist, a nuclear physicist, who actually just passed earlier in 2019. But I did this interview with him in 2015. Yeah, I think it was a really fascinating conversation. It was at the UFO Congress in Fountain Hills, Arizona, near Phoenix, near Scottsdale. And I'm going to let it be at that. We was talking about science. Stanton Friedman was one of the first civilians to be called on the scene after what was known and is known as the Roswell incident. So in some regards, he's played quite a role in helping shape the public's perception of that event, which happened in 1947. Here's Stanton Friedman.
Just kind of go with the flow, so we're good. I appreciate it. Thank you. I'm easy to get along with. Yeah, John Maluski is a physicist. I went to the Tesla Tech Conference. He talked about how to grow gold, how to precipitate gold from glass by baking it in a microwave oven. Crush up the glass and put it in a crucible and put it in a microwave, and gold, assayable gold, real stuff, precipitates out of it.
Is there that much gold in glass?
He says about $180 worth of gold in a six-pack bottle.
Wow.
You look up John Maluski. He's in Albuquerque.
Is he wealthy yet?
No. He worked for the government. Why would he be there? I think he worked, he was a physicist at Sandia Laboratories.
Oh, yeah.
And he also has a patent on a crystal filament light bulb, and it was deemed so innovative that it's actually on permanent display at the Smithsonian, but never been picked up by a manufacturer to create. We have compact fluorescent bulbs, fluorescent lights, and everything else, but this is a crystal filament, and I'm believing a full spectrum, and it was never manufactured.
Strange world we live in.
I know. I mean, those are some of the things. I mean, you start looking at, that's why I love the title of the book, Science is Wrong, Startling Truths About Cures, Theories, and Inventions They Declared Impossible. And in many ways, we're still talking about things that are impossible.
Oh, it happens all the time.
Mm-hmm.
We should put out a second volume.
Okay, update the new and improved.
There are 14 chapters there, each one headed by something stupid said by somebody smart, well-educated person.
Mm-hmm.
British Astronomer Royal in 1956 said that space travel is utter bilge. What good would it do? Nobody would spend the money. What we really need is better equipment for astronomers.
Just to look at it, space.
Yeah, and... of course, Sputnik went up the next year, and the area of interest that has benefited the most from the space program, the science of interest, is astronomy.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, there was another astronomer, an American astronomer in 1903, October, gave a long statement to the effect that if there was one thing he could be sure of, is that a man would never fly any distance in a vehicle. That was 2 months before the Wright brothers flew. And sometimes there are consequences. The doctor who figured out that the reason so many women were dying of childbed fever, this is back in the 1840s in Austria, was that the residents at the hospital would do autopsies in the morning, go downstairs and examine pregnant women without washing their hands. And he figured that out and instigated a tough program of hand washing and nail brushing and all that stuff, and reduced the percentage of childbed fever deaths from 20% to 3%. Just about as good as the midwives had already accomplished. He was fired from the hospital because that's not the way we do things here. You see, the mark of a good doctor was how bloody his apron was.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
But anyway, and there were the people who fought against the smallpox inoculations and stuff like that. Smallpox was God's way of keeping the population down.
There was Charles Creighton. Charles Creighton was a doctor in the late 19th century. He wrote extensively. He was talking about vaccination itself. That's right. This was even before. Smallpox was a part of that, but this was about vaccination itself, and that goes back to I can't think of the guy at the end of the 18th century, 1700, beginning of in London. I mean, he's lionized by the medical industry, and I can't think of. He'll pop in my mind. I don't even know if he was a doctor, but he posed the idea that cow material was a suitable substitute for dealing with smallpox than human. And see, by so doing, it made it possible to build a business around it because they could culture material. Cowpox, yes, as opposed to variolation, which is what they did before. His name is on the top of my tongue, but it ain't coming out yet. It'll be there whenever. But yeah. So, you're a physicist.
I'm a nuclear physicist. I worked only in industry on far-out, exciting, eventually canceled research and development programs. Worked for General Electric Aircraft Nuclear Propulsion Department on nuclear airplanes. I worked for Westinghouse Astronuclear Lab in Pittsburgh on nuclear rockets. I worked at Allison Division of General Motors on compact nuclear reactors. I worked on fusion propulsion for Aerojet General Nucleonics out in California. So I worked on exciting, usually classified, eventually canceled programs. And you find a lot of folks in the public are not aware of these programs. Especially what I call the ancient academics and fossilized physicists of academia, who will tell you what's impossible. One of the biggest arguments about UFOs is you can't get here from there. It's too far, take too much energy, et cetera. And the history of technology is littered with people. Well, a good example, an astronomer in Canada, Dr. Campbell, in 1941 published a paper in which he calculated the required initial launch weight of a rocket able to get a man to the moon and back. People were talking about, science fiction writers were talking about man going to the moon. And he said that's all baloney, and he was out to show it. So he wrote this long paper, which he published, in which he calculated the required initial launch weight of a rocket able to get a man to the moon and back. A legitimate question, how big does it have to be? Answer, a million tons. As it happens, we got three guys to the moon and back, still with a dumb old chemical rocket whose initial launch weight was 3,000 tons. So when you do things right, you get 3,000. You do things wrong, a million.
That's right.
And so he was one of, he made all the wrong assumptions. A single stage rocket, limited to 1G acceleration, having to provide all the energy itself instead of using cosmic freeloading, as I call it. All our deep space probes take use of the gravitational field of various and sundry heavenly bodies, including the moon when we go there. So I'm a skeptic about the debunkers of anything, especially about UFOs,
because
I find there are four basic rules. Don't bother me with the facts. My mind's made up. They haven't done their homework. I check my audiences. Fewer than 2% have read any of the five large-scale scientific studies I use as a database. Second, what the public doesn't know, I'm not going to tell them. Third, if you can't attack the data, attack the people. It's easier. And fourth, do your research by proclamation. Investigation is too much trouble. I find this particularly bad for the SETI cultists. SETI means silly effort to investigate. And I'll tell you, there is no UFO evidence. Well, they don't refer to any, that's for sure. I read their books. They sure as heck don't read mine.
I get the sense that the SETI people were the biggest skeptics. I mean, they're out to prove that they aren't there as opposed to be searching for it.
Yeah, who needs SETI if they're landing here? You need to learn sign language.
Maybe. I think so. I think so.
So it's a constant battle, and I've only given something over 700 lectures in all 50 states, 10 Canadian provinces, and 18 other countries. I get around.
Yeah.
And I've answered, I figured once, 50,000 questions between the lectures and the classrooms and the radio and television and so on. So I've heard all the arguments of the noisy negativists, and none of them stand up. There are a number of areas that they're particularly bad on. One is, can governments keep secrets? And Seth Shostak, SETI cultists, says that we can see that they can't. Just look how bad a job they've done with FEMA for Katrina. What the heck has that got to do with keeping secrets?
Right.
Look how what a bad job the post office does. Wait a minute, tell me about NSA, CIA, DIA, you know. Dr. Tyson of the Hayden Planetarium, in a lecture to 1,800 people at Penn State University, said, look, the proof governments can't keep secrets is how much we know about President Clinton's genitalia. Think about that for a minute. It makes absolutely no sense.
None at all.
You know,
at all.
Tell me about the DIA, the CIA, the NRO, the NSA. Then we've got something to go on.
Yeah.
So I get a little sick and tired of these guys with their phony arguments. And, you know, they haven't read the data. I talk usually about five large-scale scientific studies. And after each one, I present data, show slide of the cover, that sort of thing. And after each one, I say, how many people here have read this? I'm lucky if it's 1 or 2% on any of the five.
Right.
A different percentage thing. How often do people see UFOs? Well, I get people saying, I haven't heard about any sightings in the last couple of years. Well, matter of fact, MUFON has been getting over 600 sighting reports. That's Mutual UFO Network. Been getting over 600 sighting reports a month for a long time. I check my audiences. And again, at the end, this I would only do at the end of the lecture. And I'd say, I get the first question, the question answer prudent. How many people here believe they've seen what I would consider to be a flying saucer? I've defined my terms earlier in the talk. Just raise your hand, and I'll just point and count. We're not, the CIA wasn't allowed in, you know, we're not, make a joke. So off to my left, the hands go up reluctantly, you know, looking around, each one thinking he's the only one, but they trust me. They've just heard my lecture. One, two, three, four. By the time I get over to that side, the hands go up vigorously. Because suddenly, I'm not the only one.
Yes, right. Oh, it's okay now.
Typically 10%. And then I ask, how many of you reported what you saw? 90% of the hands go down. Which is par for the course.
Yes.
And I do ask another question, if it appears appropriate. How many of you were in the military at the time? The ones who reported a sighting.
Right.
If there's still a few hands, I say, you want to tell us about it. Now I'm putting them on, under the microscope. Well, one guy says in front of 1,300 people, I can't, they told me not to say anything. Which was a good line. Another guy in Indiana, college talk, he says, they took my pictures. That's all he said. And so I said, look, I'm not asking your name. You don't need to stand up. But I'm sure the audience would like to hear the rest of the story. Everybody claps. So, he says, I was flying a four-engine Air Force plane out over the Pacific. plane ahead, radios back, saucer heading your way. We had gun cameras. We took pictures. We radioed the base to which we were going because we don't handle the film. It's intelligence stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Tell them we're bringing stuff with us when we're going to land. And also, we get told we'll need to be debriefed when we arrive.
Right.
So, okay, we landed, and they took the film. Now, people seem to think pilots would take the rolls of film to the drugstore. It doesn't work that way. And we got debriefed and told never to say anything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm sure nobody disbelieved the man. He was sitting there. He was not looking for attention. I had trapped him, you might say.
The fact that they told him never to say anything, to me, is evidence that they absolutely believed him, because they did not want that information out. Yes.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
But sightings are common, is what I'm saying, everywhere
mm-hmm.
I go.
Right.
I find people who've had sightings and mostly didn't report what they saw. And, you know, there are other questions that people don't seem to be thinking very well. Why would, if aliens were coming here, why don't they land on the White House lawn? Now, think about it. The President of the United States does not speak for 7 billion Earthlings.
Mm-hmm.
He has trouble speaking for 310 million Americans.
That shows how myopic, though, Americans are. But go ahead.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. Secondly, it's a no-fly zone.
Mm-hmm.
Third, there are perfectly obvious reasons, when you stop to think about it, why aliens would want to come here and not want to land and talk to the people any more than I talk to the squirrels in my backyard,
mm-hmm.
which is not very often.
Mm-hmm.
I make one assumption about every advanced civilization. It's concerned about its own survival and security.
Mm-hmm.
If it wasn't, it wouldn't survive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, at the end of World War, that has a requirement to go with it. You got to keep tabs on the primitives in the neighborhood, but only close tabs on those primitives who show signs of being able to bother you.
Mm-hmm.
The end of World War II, there were three signs that soon these idiot Earthlings, after all, we only killed 50 million of our own kind and
mm-hmm.
destroyed 1,700 cities. I call that idiot Earthlings.
Yes, I do too.
Soon these idiot Earthlings would be going out. The three things were nuclear weapons, powerful rockets, V-2s and stuff,
mm-hmm.
which were used for killing, not for carrying the mail.
Yes.
And powerful radar, which was the beginning of the electronics age. It
mm-hmm.
didn't exist before World War II.
Energy field dynamics and things like that. Yep.
Electromagnetics.
Yep, electromagnetics, yes.
And isn't it amazing that the only place in the world in July 1947 where you could study all three of those was southeastern New Mexico.
Fascinating.
That's where Roswell is. That's where the first atomic bomb was tested,
mm-hmm.
in Trinity Site on White Sands Missile Range.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we were testing those nasty rockets.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we had our best radar. Because
mm-hmm.
sometimes the rockets went south instead of north. The Mexicans weren't very happy about that.
Mm-hmm.
We'd like to know where the rocket came.
Mm-hmm.
So the other obvious fact is we have figured out how the stars produce their energy.
Mm-hmm.
1938, theoretically, we went through the stage of fission. 1945, first atomic bomb,
mm-hmm.
released the energy of 18,000 tons of TNT.
Mm-hmm.
Our biggest bomb in 1944 was a 10-ton blockbuster.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we upped the ante. 7 years later, after 45, 1952, we tested Mike, our first H-bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Released the energy of 10 million tons of TNT.
Okay.
That's enough energy control to get us to the stars. I've worked on fusion propulsion systems.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you're not going to wait until the guys show up at your door with their bombs and their attitudes. You're going to want to make
true.
Sure that...
And the thing is, here this advanced potential has been shown, but the civilization, the proclivity to get along with each other has not been demonstrated.
Well, we have one little proof of that. The military budget this year for planet Earth is $1 trillion.
Mm-hmm.
Look how many kids die of
preventable
disease.
That's the published one.
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
Look how many kids die of preventable disease or starvation.
Absolutely, yes.
What you could do with that $1 trillion, in
mm-hmm.
other words. So, it's funny. It's the ancient academics who don't seem to understand that research gets done in places other than academia.
Mm-hmm.
and I worked in industry. We did lots of expensive research on very exciting projects, fission rockets, nuclear airplanes. Well, look at the Navy. First nuclear submarine was 1956, the Nautilus.
Mm-hmm.
We now have nuclear-powered aircraft carriers that, would you believe, can operate for 18 years without refueling. 18 years.
Sure. Yep. Submarines, too, I would imagine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right? Long time.
Mm-hmm.
And so people are being very short-sighted when they talk about some of these things, mm-hmm. about you can't get here from there, and why would they do it?
Mm-hmm.
And I find that many people have no idea how long it takes at 1G acceleration to get to the speed of light.
Mm-hmm.
I've had professors guess 1,000 years, 100 years, 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
1 lousy year.
Mm-hmm.
That's all it takes.
Wow.
And
wow.
So the reality is there aren't any good arguments against flying saucers. There are people who are ignorant and haven't studied the relevant data.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sorry, that's my job. Expose the ignorance and put the facts on the table.
Wow. So here's a question. Two things. One, Edward Jenner was the guy.
Oh, yes.
I knew I'd come up with it. It'd pop up. I kept thinking Bruce Jenner, all right? And so I had to get that out the way there for a second. Question, though, especially with your experience in rocketry and the speed of light. Everything, all of our science, still, not all of it, but the majority of scientific thoughts puts the speed of light as the barrier that can't be.
But it's not a problem. Mm-hmm. You can't, let's not settle for half an Einstein.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Half is that the speed of light represents a limit.
Mm-hmm.
The other half is you get close to the speed of light, time slows down for things moving that fast.
Yes, yes.
Which sounds crazy as can be, but it's been demonstrated.
Mm-hmm.
And so at 99.9% of the speed of light, you can go 37 light years in 6 months, pilot time.
Mm-hmm.
Pilot time. You go out, come back, marry your granddaughter's best friend, and mm-hmm. away you go.
Right.
That big collider, LHC, at CERN in Europe,
mm-hmm.
particles go 99.999% of the speed of light.
Mm-hmm.
That's a realm that we do operate in.
Mm-hmm.
And so what's the big deal? Yes, the universe is big, so what?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not trying to go way out there. Within 50 light years of Earth, there's well over 1,000 stars.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want a different situation from ours, I mean, the nearest star to the sun is 4.3 light years away.
Yeah, and Andromeda, isn't it?
No.
Alpha Centauri. Yes. I just finished reading a book called Beyond the Light Barrier. I'm going to talk to you about.
Okay.
Yes, go ahead.
Well, the kicker here is that in the famous abduction of Betty and Barney Hill,
mm-hmm.
described in my book Captured by mm-hmm. Kathleen Marden, Betty's niece,
mm-hmm.
and myself, there was a star map seen by Betty, described under hypnosis, and Dr. Simon, the psychiatrist, had her draw it later on if she could remember it accurately.
Mm-hmm.
It was drawn. A brilliant woman named Marjorie Fish did something nobody else had ever done. She built a total of 27 different three-dimensional maps, models,
mm-hmm.
of our local galactic neighborhood. What turns out, she was able to find one map that matched what Betty had drawn. And that tells us what the base stars are in that map.
Mm-hmm.
They happen to be Zeta 1 and Zeta 2 Reticuli. The constellation is Reticulum, the net, that
mm-hmm.
means in Latin.
Mm-hmm.
And those two stars are 39.3 light years from here, which is just down the street.
Mm-hmm.
They're only an eighth of a light year apart from each other, which is 30 times closer to each other than the sun is to the next star over. We're mm-hmm. out in the boonies.
Right.
And they happen to be a cool billion years older than the sun.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you'd think there'd be a lot more incentive to develop interstellar travel when you got a next-door neighbor,
right?
Uh-huh. As they do.
Mm-hmm.
And furthermore, each star is visible from the other one all day long,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of neat. And you would be able to determine whether there's biological life, plant life and stuff on the other planets or on the other stars.
Mm-hmm.
So people act as if aliens would send out probes randomly. Does any airline do that? You're going from point A to point B because
right.
there's a lot of interest in traveling between those
simple
two.
Simple as that, yes.
Los Angeles and New York.
Mm-hmm.
not Podunk and Lower Slavonia.
They don't spray those out there, yeah.
No. So it seems to me, when you start looking at the evidence, there are no good arguments. There are landing trace cases. One guy's collected 4,000 from 80 countries.
Mm-hmm.
There are the abduction cases. Now, I'm not saying every reported UFO is an alien spacecraft.
Mm-hmm.
Or anybody who claims to have been abducted or lost missing time has been abducted.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, maybe not. But there are enough good ones, real solid cases, to say, yes, people are being abducted by aliens. And who knows what they're here for? I mean, maybe they're grad students doing their thesis work on the development of a primitive society.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they got a weekly show on television, Idiocy in the Boondocks.
There you go. You could say maybe Evolution for Dummies, you know, because we could certainly come down and show that, you know.
Yeah, and the thing is that we tend to lose sight of another factor. We've got a few thousand years of history. It's been around for 4.5 billion years.
Yes, yes.
I mean, I know that Bishop Usher said it was all created 4004 B.C.
Mm-hmm.
on a Thursday afternoon in October,
uh-huh.
I believe. I think we have an enormous amount of evidence saying that the planet is billions of years old,
mm-hmm,
as
sure.
opposed to a few thousand.
Mm-hmm.
So, and one thing that has changed a great deal, the Kepler space satellite, mm-hmm. which I really love that baby. It's looking at a chunk of the sky about as big as your hand at arm's length, like your fist at arm's length.
Mm-hmm.
And this goes out and around and back and out in an elongated path.
Mm-hmm.
And it's measuring the stars in that region.
Mm-hmm.
And every time it goes a certain part, it looks for reductions in the light coming from that star, meaning that a planet has gone across the face.
Yes.
And it is so blasted sensitive, it could pick up a butterfly in front of a car headlight 2 miles away. I
mm-hmm.
mean, that's the kind of sensitivity.
Mm-hmm.
So it has already found thousands of planets, and every indication we're talking with a few billion in the galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be we thought we were the only ones. This was the only solar system.
Oh.
No way, Jose.
All that is fading away. That's becoming the, well... not even myth anymore. I mean, it is clear. They are there.
Yeah.
Now, I got a question. With all of the evidence of the that this planet has been, is being visited, you might also talk in terms of and taking the factor that 90%+ of the energy of the universe is considered dark matter or and or energy,
yes.
so to speak. Is it possible... or has the subject of superluminosity come into play yet? I mean, is it possible that they have moved through the time through the light barrier, rather, that they're going faster than light for parts of their...
I can't say it's impossible. I will leave room for it.
Okay. I can
say it isn't necessary.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big step.
Okay.
You know, and mm-hmm. look at the progress we've made. My mantra is technological progress comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Magellan, Ferdinand Magellan,
mm-hmm. circumnavigated the world, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And his ship did it in 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't make it.
Mm-hmm.
That was in 1523. Around the world in 80 days, 1880 or so.
Mm-hmm.
The space station goes around the world in 90 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So in less than 500 years, we've gone from 3 years to 90 minutes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the space station is not just a faster sailboat.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, altogether different. So we sometimes forget that. It was brought home to me. I was talking to a bunch of college students in Michigan, and I was going through how, in my lifetime, how much technology has changed.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, heck, when I was working in industry, I used a slide rule.
Mm-hmm. I remember that, too.
And I looked around the class, didn't see anybody bat an eye, and I finally bit the bullet and said, any of you know what a slide rule is?
Yeah.
Not once.
Uh-huh.
That was less than 50 years.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is we have plenty of evidence that progress comes from doing things differently.
Yeah.
don't tell me you couldn't do it the old way. I'm looking for the new way.
Right, right.
You know, slide rules and pocket calculators aren't the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
With their capabilities. So I'm trying to get people, and I will here, to take a new view of the cosmos. That's my paper title on Saturday. And I usually find people are responsive, receptive. They hadn't, the biggest response to the questions they pose, oh, I hadn't thought of it that way. Like, people want to know the answer to the why questions. I show them facts and data, that's easy to accept, but why doesn't the government tell us what it knows? Why would an alien come here? You know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I find that when I give my answers, the response is, oh, I hadn't thought of that before. Which is good, you've got them thinking.
That's for sure. Well, that's good. Well, I tell you, there's a lot more thinking I think we need to do because our culture is such that we tend to anesthetize the thinking, whether it's by, you know, environment, whether it's the processed foods. And we do a lot of things to just really gunk things up. And we don't also, at least not enough, we don't encourage... I don't say critical thinking, but you can say creative thinking.
Right.
We don't encourage people questioning and being confident in whatever their feeling is without having someone else be wrong. You know, it's really all right to not agree with someone or not see things in the same way, and yet you don't have to be so needing to be right that you have to kill them in order
We don't need nasty, noisy, negative ones.
Absolutely, absolutely. So this is some of the, I like to say, the intramural adolescent stuff that we do as humanity, that if I'm sitting back in some place where we figured out how to get from here to Alpha Centauri in 4 hours, no, 7 hours, this book that I read is a woman who, Elizabeth Clara was her name. She's from South Africa.
She took a lot of pictures of UFOs.
Well, not only that, she fell in love. This is a love story. This is an interstellar love story where her man, if you will, I'll just put it that way, came from Alpha Centauri, a planet called Meton, and they described it took 7 hours to get there. Now, the 7 hours, 3.5 was to get up to light speed, and then they were here instantly to get to the edge of our solar system, and then 3.5 to come down. So that, and they had to do it far enough not to disturb the space-time continuum of the planet.
Okay.
I mean, there's a logical description of this, you know.
What can I say?
So, at any rate, yeah, it's called Beyond the Light Barrier. And they also talked about the fact that when we were coming to the sound barrier, you know, there was all, you know, there, people lost their lives, there was all stuff like that. And yet we figured out making, Chuck Yeager made some very small movements and made it through. They said the light barrier is the same.
Might very well be.
Yeah, so it's an interesting thing. I know what you're saying. So it's a pleasure to talk to you, Dr. Friedman.
Mr. No free degrees.
Absolutely,
please.
Absolutely.
Unless somebody gives me an honorary one, then I'll accept it.
Okay. I'll be looking out for some more things. I'm going to ask you to sign this, too. Thank you so much. Stanton Friedman here at the 2013 UFO Congress. I hope you enjoyed our visit with Stanton Friedman, late as it may be, or late as he may be, as the case, as you might want to say, depending on the context. But I actually enjoyed watching that and rediscovering that video, and it turns out I have more. So I'm going to be a pretty busy camper introducing videos like that. I'll be introducing videos that had been previously available. Some people have
expressed some desire to see some of my previous videos that were on my channel that was taken off. And, you know, I have an idea about what was the subject matter that was verboten at the time. Not everything was. So I think I'm going to be okay. I'm going to presume I will be. And we'll find other places for those other things if there is a desire for it. But that is what we have for now. If you find this conversation of benefit and of interest and like more of it, well, we'll be here again sometime soon. I'll continue to work my process out from audio to focus to lighting, but nonetheless, and also regularity. But thanks for being here. Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for thinking about the things that we talk about, that we bring to your attention. There's quite a bit that calls for fresh consideration, a fresh look. That's why we cannot be in a position to presume that because scientists have said something, have declared something, that it is so. There is what science says, there's what anyone says, but the truth of it needs to be vetted. And if it's true, it'll play out regardless of who said it. Being a scientist doesn't really mean diddly, if you know what I mean. So until next time, thank you for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you again when we return here at Regenerative Mind. I'm Adam Abraham. Peace, be well, and I love you all.